Well, good morning, those of you who are joining us today. We're glad that you've made time to be a part of the Healthy Pastors, Healthy Families webinar series. Really excited to be with you today. Co-hosted and hosted by the EPC and PIR Ministries. I'm Roy Yankee, the Executive Director of PIR Ministries and co-host and great friend, Annie Rose, who is the Director of Ministerial Support and Development for the EPC. And Annie, I think we have a special guest with us today. Who is that?
We sure do, Roy. We are very blessed today to have with us licensed therapist Kim Hoke. Kim lives and serves the Lord in Indianapolis, Indiana. She is a licensed therapist who specializes in trauma and narrative therapy, and she's going to tell us more about what that means and the kind of work that she does to help people move toward greater healing. Kim also shares life with her husband, Rob Hoke, who is the senior pastor of Southport Presbyterian Church there in the Indianapolis area. And so we are incredibly blessed today to have Kim speak to us, not only as a therapist with her professional expertise, but also from her life experience as one who serves as a pastor's wife. So, Kim, thank you so much for being with us today. We are so grateful to have you talk with us about what it means that we are created for relationship and how we can thrive as ministry families. So, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and the work that you do?
Yeah, hi, welcome. And I will say a little bit about myself is I'll start with what I love. I love adventure. I love travel. I have a great passion for beauty and for the goodness of beauty in others' lives and in my own. Some of my favorite things to do is to drive my Jeep on country roads with the top off and the doors off. I love reading poetry. I love being in or near any kind of water and outdoors, and I love to dance. I dance a lot. I've been married for 29 years. We together have four adult children, one who is married and one about to be married. So we currently are a tribe of eight, just a lot. We just went on a road trip, all eight of us. That was very fun. my husband has been a pastor or in ministry for 30 years. And I have a deep love for Jesus, and that relationship with Jesus has changed over the years, continues to evolve almost daily into a deeper love even today. About 8 years ago, I began to discover that the life I was living was not really being lived at all. And I found that instead of becoming more and more of who I was actually becoming less and less and shrinking and shriveling. Life had gotten very hard. Ministry had gotten very hard. And so between family of origin, harm and trauma, and the immense harm that we have experienced through the years from different churches or in different churches and in ministry, I began to disappear a bit. And so just kind of took me to a different level of probably anxiety and depression and all sorts of other things that were involved there. And it began to expose that stress began to expose my own childhood trauma in new ways. And I began to pursue therapy. What else? Then so from there, kind of, though, I began to understand my own gifting and been in training really to be a therapist most of my life, I discovered. I had a therapist who saw me well, and she walked me through quite a few things of doubts and fears and questions that I couldn't reveal or be with in any other space. Because I was the wife of a pastor. So, and then through that, I decided to go back to school in 2018, pursue a counseling degree. And at the same time, I began training with the Allender Center. All my training and schooling was done in 2021 and 2022, began pursuing being licensed. So I've been seeing clients for 3 years now, developing groups and weekends, I tend to invite people to dive into their stories, engage their bodies, and approach themselves and their young selves with tender kindness. That's kind of where I see I provide a lot of space for people to begin exploring and being really curious about things that maybe they haven't been able to be. And I see people individually through like this telehealth, and I have two story groups. And then I also facilitate weekend intensives with women in this kind of the same type of setting of exploring their stories.
That's absolutely terrific. And I'm really glad that we're able as a ministry, I'm just a side note on this, that PIR Ministries has partnered with you as well, along with several other really great coaches and counselors, and have really enjoyed being a partner with you in this work. So first question, okay.
Yeah.
Being a pastor's spouse, being in a pastoral family situation, probably most pastors and families experience the paradoxes of that. Can you talk a little bit about those paradoxes and how they impact a pastoral family as they try to live life and do ministry?
Yeah, for sure. I think I named when I think of those paradoxes, I think I named a few, and I'll go through this idea of we're expected to be normal, but we're not really normal. We're known really well, but we're not really known. We're in community, and yet there's a way in which we're not really part of community. And when you're in ministry, I think all those are true. And I will say, kind of before I will premise this with, I don't actually believe there is a notion of normal, but for this context, I think you guys know what I'm saying. I just think, which is part of the problem that we think there is a normal, right? But as a ministry family, I think there's a pressure to fit in and to match or to morph into what the norm considers to be okay. And yet ministry is pretty strange. I think of it like this, where you never really leave your job with ministry. And I know that there's other professions that are similar, but in speaking of ministry, I would say for many families, mom and dad in the workforce go to work and come home. And if there's problems at work, well, the family doesn't necessarily hear about it. Or if they do, it doesn't really impact them much. It may impact them in where mom or dad get busier in seasons, or they may be under more stress in seasons, but the family itself kind of can stay intact in those situations most of the time, right? But it doesn't, it's a little different. So if we speak from the point of view of a ministry kid, for example, when something goes wrong in ministry, where there's a problem at work, all areas of that child's life is impacted. So, for example, I can't tell you how many times our kids have inquired about a friend or a family or someone who's had a problem with their dad and a decision the church has made, and that those people are no longer in their lives. Like, people just leave, or they get upset and then they cause turmoil, or they make comments, and the family is always a part of that. Countless people who have been surrogate grandparents or aunts and uncles to my kids may just no longer exist in their lives. That's a great loss. So there's no normal for them. I think that's kind of what I talk about, or what I think about when I think about this normal, but not normal. Yeah. Mom or dad may go off to a job, but the way the job, the vocation of ministry impacts, tends to impact a family's entire community. and the experience of relationships is very different, I think, than the average family. The idea of being known and not known, I mean, that's kind of like this idea of we're in a fishbowl, right? It's almost a celebrity mentality. Everybody knows who the pastor's kids are or who the ministry kids are, or the spouse, right? And yet many, we're not really known in the ways that others are known. We're just kind of known who we are. And I think the same way goes for in community or not part of community. My knowledge or my experience has been, we've always been transplanted. Many ministry families are transplanted. And seldom that you're serving, where you're serving in your area or your church is the place where you've always been or all of your extended family is, right? You're transplanted. And so you have to insert yourself into a community and know you're not actually yet part of that community and could leave at any time. It just feels like a super fragile place where, for a ministry family to truly be part of the family that they serve or the community they serve, takes an immense amount of courage and risk and continued risk. So I think those paradoxes can be really confusing. They create a loss of sense of self. They set up for a lot of loss in relationship. They set up for isolation and lack of belonging. And I think it's important to recognize that position and be sensitive to that and have places of true belonging to support that doesn't hang with that constant possibility of being judged or losing your job, which I think kind of sits there for a lot of people in ministry.
Oh, it's so true, Kim. And as you were talking about those realities, just, you know, the fragile state of the relationships and kind of this contingent feeling, I was thinking, especially for a pastor's children, you know, they don't get to be a part of that decision-making conversation if a move is going to come, or, you know, are we going to apply for another call or look for another call? And so from the kids' perspective, just all of that fragility and having no control, really, you know, the potential for that feeling of helplessness is just tremendous. So, you know, in talking about some of these paradoxes, one of the realities that often accompanies ministry, sadly, is that sense of isolation, that sense of not truly belonging in community, not truly experiencing the kind of vulnerable, intimate relationships that we all need in order to thrive. What are some signs, like if we're the pastor or if we're a pastor's spouse, what are some of the signs that we might see in ourselves or in our family members that tell us that we are really struggling with isolation?
Yeah, can I share a quick story referring to what you just talked about first?
Absolutely.
What you said reminded me of our last move, which was like 12 years ago. At this point, one of our children really struggled, and he was pretty young. I think he was like 6 or 7 at the time, and literally wept and cried for weeks every day. And I just held him and why do we have to be here? And I would say, well, because daddy's being called here. And of course, he's like, well, but I'm not being called. God's not calling me here. You know. So yeah, there is such a lack of control and decision-making and all that. So yes, sorry, that was just a side note of something that I thought of while you were talking.
It's so true. We've all, I mean, I've experienced that with my kids too. It's heartbreaking. Yeah.
So I'm pretty sure, yeah, well, I don't speak from a theological perspective here necessarily, but I'm pretty sure isolation is a very sweet tactic of the enemy, and feels like it sneaks up on us before we realize we're actually in it. And it's like we're 5 miles down the road in isolation before there's any realization. But I do think there are signs, and I don't know that I have like a, here are the signs isolation is having, but I would say from my experience, if there's a sense of, I can't share this with anyone, that's a red flag. or you find yourself in places where there's no space at all to talk about a fight with your spouse, or the financial mess you're in, or something your kids have done, if you don't have spaces for those, you're already in isolation. If you have an internal dialogue that's trying to figure out how to hide something, maybe that your kids have said or done, or telling your family at any point, don't tell anyone this, you're already in isolation. If you've got nowhere to say, you know what, some days I'm not sure I believe God exists, or that God is really as good as he says he is, because everything I'm in does not feel good, or any questions of your faith, you're already in isolation. If you have nowhere to put voice or words to those things, if you find you have secrets that if anyone knew them, you know, you'd be fired, or you can't voice any of it, you're in deep isolation. And I think, here's the thing. I think isolation is a human condition. It's not a ministry condition. It's a human condition. And as Dan Allender phrases it, he says, we are meant for relationship. We're created for relationship. And yet we're harmed in relationships. And that leaves us in quite a bind, right? But the thing is that we are healed in relationship. So the only cure for the human condition of isolation is human connection. And somehow, I feel like the Big C Church, we've set up our ministry leaders. We've set them up for isolation. People in ministry are in ministry because of their love for God and their love for people. And yet, they're in a place where the standards are so high and the loss of connection is so great that there's no choice but to isolate. And that just feels... we're missing something. We're missing something. And so, yeah, the flags to me is if there's already an internal thought of, I can't say this, you're in isolation.
That is so true. And, you know, there are competing ideas out there about whether pastors and their families should have those kinds of relationships that can be healthy within the local body, or they have to seek them outside, which is really kind of sad in many ways when you think about the nature of the body of Christ as it should be. But what are some healthy ways that you've seen or experienced or would recommend that pastors and their spouses and families can find those kinds of connections and have those kind of relationships where those needs can be met and there's the ability to be authentic?
Yeah. I found it in both, right? Like, I have found connection within the community and outside. And again, I don't know that there's like a step by step, but my number one thing I would say, so it's kind of biased, therapy. The therapeutic relationship, if done well, is a beautiful place to begin to have secure attachment and transparent relationship. Now, a therapeutic relationship is not mutual, nor does it provide reciprocity in the way of a friendship does, but it does provide a safe, non-judgmental space for all the things that do not feel safe elsewhere. And I would die on the hill, I think, of pastors really need to be in therapy. I would say the age-old advice of having some deep mutual relationships outside the church is really good. It's for all of you, the whole family, not just the ministry spouse, right? Or the person in ministry. I would say everyone, all of you I would want deep mutual relationships outside of the community you're serving. I don't think it's impossible. As I said, I've had them, but it's a little messier. And I think ministry, vocational ministry and families in ministry are immensely adept at very complex relationships. We have to do it all the time, right? So it's not impossible to have a relationship within the community. It's just gonna, at times I kind of think of it, it's not in all ways like this, but I'm not necessarily friends with my clients. I'm not friends with my clients. That'd be unethical, right? Yet, there is a relationship we have that's profound. So I think the idea, I think what happens is there's a pedestal or this fishbowl mentality, right? And I think we have to begin developing within our ministry environment this idea of working with elders, inviting a different atmosphere. Ministry family is not an example. They're not always leaders. They're not on display. They're just people. And our kids repeatedly communicated how they wish they could be a kid in the youth group, not an example and not another leader. They were always put in a group, not with their friends, because they were good with people or good with leading. They were put with the kids who needed more encouragement or whatever, which is not a bad thing. It's a great model. And our kids wanted to just be kids. All of them were natural leaders for sure, but they didn't always want to be the leader. They wanted to be ministered to, and they needed that. And I think that's where we can begin a shifting the expectation or environment within our churches that doesn't set up for pastors to be so elevated that they can't have relationships within the community. I think it begins with almost a culture shift, right? I think historically, in many churches, the pastor has been it, right? The pastor or the ministry leaders, they're the ones above reproach. They're the ones leading. And so, of course, we have to hold them and set them apart. That's not wrong. I think that that's all very true. I just also believe it sets up for a pretty dangerous situation to not have good, deep relational connections. And so, yeah, I think both are possible. I think therapy is a place to start.
Thank you, Kim. Absolutely. One, continuing on that topic of, you know, kind of navigating the relationship between the pastor's family and the congregation, how, you know, the pastor really, in terms of the pastor's family, it's really the pastor, the person who has received the call to this congregation, that's in the prime position to be able to set the tone and kind of try to set some norms for how that's going to go. What are some ways that a pastor can lead the congregation and especially the elders to relate to their family in a healthy and appropriate way?
Yeah, I think about one of our interview process times we were interviewing with a church, and I'm pretty sure my husband may have asked, like, what are your expectations on my wife and my family or something like that? And they made a profound statement that I just wish everyone would say is, well, we're hiring you, not your wife. And I've run the gamut in 29 years of being the wife of a pastor. I've run the gamut of how involved or how not involved or different places where I am involved in the community. And I just really appreciate the freedom to be able to do what I desire to do. Yeah, it kind of goes with what I was just talking about, that there's an invitation to begin looking at things differently. We have to. How is it, to me, I keep thinking of how is it that we continue to hear in the news, online, our heroes of faith or dynamic leaders in the faith every year, multiple times a year, having affairs, sexual addictions, other addictions, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Like, it feels epidemic, right? And so to me, there's a problem. And I feel like that's the call to a culture change. We can't necessarily change the big C, but we can begin with our local churches, allowing, and I think really simple of kind of the things I've said, allowing ministry kids to be kids, that they actually might smoke pot and cuss. And it's not that we want them to, but they might. And that doesn't mean we're parenting incorrectly or we're doing something wrong. Allow ministry spouses to be involved or not involved. And inviting, I think, leaders, elders, to not have judgment towards that. I once experienced a comment about how all the ministry families were sitting in one area of the sanctuary for worship, and how that we should change that up. Like, we should split up. And I get it. Like, I see the concern. I understand. I see that people want them to sit and spread out to show community, but I also kind of get like, can they choose to sit where they want to sit, wherever that is that they want to sit? And it doesn't need to have carry other meaning and anything except that's where they like to sit. And can that be okay in your church? And can you begin to have those conversations that when those comments are made, we say, well, yeah, I understand. And they can choose where they want to sit. So I think we start slowly, we start gently. Anytime there's culture shift, there's going to be pushback. But we also have to begin with ourselves. And if we walk around with a veil of being careful of everything our family says or does, mixed in the salad of fear and what other people think, then we're actually asking and inviting others to do the same. So it's our own freedom and our own liberation, our own way in which we get to navigate ourselves and becoming more comfortable with that. I think that starts with doing your own work. Honestly, we can't invite others to think any differently if we don't think any differently about it. So.
Absolutely. That's what I was just thinking. You know, it's so important, again, because the pastor has this call to the congregation, because they have an employment relationship with the congregation, they really are the ones who need to be able to say, you know, thank you so much for sharing that concern. Here's why we're not going to do that. you know, having those healthy boundaries. And it really comes down to doing your own work as a leader, being in spaces, being in relationships where you can deal with your own, you know, potential for being a people pleaser, or, you know, your struggle to be a differentiated leader and not just get sucked into the environment around you. You're not going to be able to hold those healthy boundaries for your family if you're not doing your own work with the Lord's help. So absolutely. Well, you know, Kim, we know nobody comes into the ministry, or no one comes into a ministry family without baggage. We all have wounds that we carry from the past, from our family of origin, from experiences that we've had in our growing up years. Talk a little bit about how the particular stresses of ministry can really stir up past trauma. What are some of the things you've seen?
Yeah, I think any amount of stress that we go through is going to unveil or expose past trauma. Our past is not ever really past. It's always present, right? And no matter how much we think or we believe or we have dealt with our past, I don't really think our past is something to be dealt with. I actually think it's something to join, carry with. And so it becomes part of how we relate. It becomes part of how we show up in the world. It actually is part of why we're called to what we're called to, and what our tendencies are under stress. To be fair, ministry is remarkably stressful. It has its own unique stressors. We know them. We may not actually be able to put perfect words to them, but we know them, we feel them, things will happen. My husband likes to say the sheep do bite. And if we don't know ourselves, if we don't know our stories, if we don't know our trauma, then all we're doing is perpetuating a cycle when stress arrives. And that's why I urge people, well, I urge all people, but people in ministry to know your own story. And honestly, we can't do that on our own. I utilize an analogy, and it's not a great analogy, but it's from my imagination. So imagine with me that you live inside a balloon, and everything you see is from inside the balloon, right? We can't actually see anything from any other perspective because we're inside, unless someone else offers it, right? And I think that's how stories work. We only have one perspective, and it's from inside our story. Without others' help, therapists, etc., we continue to live out of only one perspective. And in ministry, I think we truly want to love people, right? And yet we can only love people to the degree that we're able to receive love. We can only walk with people to the point of where we've already walked. So if you're in ministry with people, don't you want to walk with them as far as possible? And if you do, you have to do your own work so you can. It's always going to stir up our trauma when our stress levels, our trauma is going to be with us no matter what. And it can come out sideways, or it can come out and actually be utilized. I define trauma as the body's response to overwhelm. So if we say it in that way, we all have it. We all have it. And our experiences in life, so many of them involve that trauma. And if we don't dig deep into the fuller story, the fuller narrative, then we put ourselves in a bind as we try to do ministry. We're stuck. We can't actually do any more because we only have this one narrative. But if we begin to kind of see what other people are seeing, if we begin to do our own work, if we begin to notice what the stressors are and how they come out of us, then we actually can be more effective in what we are pursuing.
One of the most important questions, I think, in the world is the question why, which goes to the understanding our stories, right? You know, why do I respond the way I do? Mm-hmm. Why do I feel the way I do? And unless we do that kind of work, we are truncating our ability to really live well, but also to serve well, I think, as well. So what are some of the common trauma responses that you've seen in the church? The things that the families face, how can we begin to address those in the church?
Yeah, I was thinking about this question, and there's so many ways to go with this, but I think clinically speaking, as a therapist, I would say a trauma response usually falls into our categories of fight, flight, freeze, or fawn. It's our nervous system's response to this overwhelm or the feeling of unsafety. And it's the way in which our system then creates safety and brings safety. So many of us live in that constantly, which is really unhelpful for ourselves and for others. But how I see that play out, there's a few ways. I think of there's often a flight. We want to leave or move to another church or have the desire to. Sometimes there's a fight. And I would say most often we fawn. And fawn being that submit and appease response. I'm going to submit and appease to make sure I don't make waves, to make sure I survive through this. And the problem with that is, again, we're contorting and morphing into something that we're not, right? Like we're trying to be what others want us to be in doing that. And it's not a bad trauma responses are, they help us survive. They help us make it through. They're good. And yet sometimes if we continue in them, or they just might not serve us as well anymore. We have trauma responses that were created in our developmental years of our developmental nervous system that we still do as adults. And that's where they may not serve us as well. So I think the first invitation would be to notice what is your thought process and stress? What's the internal dialogue? Can you begin to notice that? Can you begin to notice when you are stressed? To be fair, a lot of us, me included, I'm 3 days into stress before I realize, oh, wait, this is stress, right? And so, you know, it's effort and it's work to begin to notice the signs early on. I find we have to find ways to relieve stressors. We talked at the beginning. I didn't say when I introduced myself, I didn't say who I was as far as the wife of a pastor and what I do. I started with what I love because I've had to work really hard to find what I love and to engage in what I love, because that is one of the number one things that keeps me away from having to have these stress responses, is to engage in beauty, in outdoors, in water, in dance. Those are the things that I have found, and everyone's different in what they want to experience or what they love to experience that helps with those stressors. I think there's has to be boundaries. We know this. We all know it. And yet how we enforce boundaries is directly related to how we experienced or did not experience boundaries in childhood. So we have to explore. I think those are notice and explore. We tend to also own another kind of place to that I would see a stress response is when there's a lot of contempt, self-contempt and other-centered contempt. If you're noticing a lot of self-judgment or judgment on others, may want to begin to explore that. I think it's Romans 2:4. It's the kindness of God that leads to repentance. We honestly have no problem with shaming ourselves and shaming others, but can we invite kindness into our experiences, into our responses? It's really hard to be judgmental when we lead with curiosity. And so I don't know if that really answers the question very much, but notice, explore, curiosity, those are all just softer words, softer ways in which we approach ourselves and others and our families. Do you see it? Do you see when your kids are under stress? Do you have avenues and ways for them to honor that stress and be with it and then move through it? Do they know how to? They may not know how to because you may not know how to. So we may need to start with co-regulation in order to co-regulate with our families too. I'm introducing all sorts of stuff that probably needs like 10 more hours of explanation, but I'll stop there.
No, that's great, Kim. This has been such a fun and just a really stimulating conversation. I have like 3 follow-up questions, so I'm trying to decide which one I want to land on. I think though, co-regulation is such an important concept. And so for those who might be watching who aren't familiar, if you wouldn't mind explaining that a little bit, especially for the sake of parents, I think that would be really helpful.
Yeah, I have a good word picture for that one. I always think of our kids when they were real little and we would go to the ocean. We went to Gordon Conwell. So we were like, I don't know, just a few miles from the ocean. And I would take, my little one to the ocean. And when she was tiny and could walk and even run, like you walk them up, but the waves will lap up and chase them. And so they turn around and squeal and run, right? And then they get a little bit braver and they might like get their toes wet, and then they run, and then they get braver and braver. And we move closer and closer. And as they kind of move closer, you are holding their hand, right? And it might go to their knees. And then you might teach them to kind of turn around as the crest breaks over. And so it hits their back, and you're still holding your hand. And then they might get older and you're still kind of guiding them through. Okay, now we can jump over the waves, or now we have a boogie board and we can jump on it and ride. And then as they get older and older, we teach them when is the right point to dive under the waves. And when is the right point to just ride it back into shore? And then sometimes they might get taken out, right? And when they get taken out, they come up and there's another one to take them out. And sometimes they might need help, and we grab their arm and like lift them up so that they can catch their breath, right? And eventually we teach them to get to the other side of the crest. And when they get to the other side of the crest, the waves are still there, but they're swells. And we get to ride them, and we get to enjoy them. We get to float on them. And they're not as terrifying because we taught them how to get through. And we taught them what to do in the different waves. And that's kind of how I feel about emotions, is their waves, their energy, their movement through our body. And there's ways in which we move with the emotion. It doesn't work to stop them. It doesn't work to just be taken out by them. And yet we don't know that. And the co-regulation is all of that I said, of guiding them with their hands, lifting them out of the water, teaching them how to jump, teaching them how to dive, getting them to the other side to say, oh, see here, we're okay here. And we can just enjoy the waves now. And they're not as big and they don't take us out as much. And so that to me is a picture of co-regulation, and how many of us never had that. And so emotions come and we are taken out and we don't know what to do. And we think we're going to die and we can't catch our breath. And it feels that way, right? And we may need somebody to kind of lift us out and show us how to navigate those spaces.
Oh, that was a great image. That's a really helpful way of explaining co-regulate. I wish someone had talked to me about that when I was pregnant with my first child. Thank you for laying that out in such a beautiful way. Before we go to our last question that Roy and I have for you, I wanted to make sure our viewers know you are welcome to submit questions through the Q&A feature on the bottom of your screen. If you have anything you would like to ask him, please feel free to submit that. But Kim, you know, a lot of us haven't had the opportunity to experience healthy co-regulation in life, as you said. And so when the emotions come, we kind of get taken out, or maybe our bodies have to finally get our attention to let us know that something's wrong. Maybe, you know, for me, I've struggled with migraines for the last 17 years, and I'm coming to a better place with it, but I've learned that is one of my body's favorite ways of processing stress. Other people, I've known friends who had to have a heart attack before they really paid attention to their emotional life. But you, as a therapist, are in a position of constantly inviting people to do that deep inner work, to become more aware of their stories and how they're impacting their present. Tell us a little bit about the work you do with individuals versus groups, and the story groups that you do. Like, what are the pros and cons of each? And if somebody was interested in getting a hold of you and finding out more about those opportunities, how can they do that? How can they find you?
Yeah. Okay. So this is like a little bit biased because I absolutely love groups. So that doesn't mean I don't love individual work as well, but I do love groups because I feel like there's a magic that happens with groups that is quite profound. So I would say, so the work I do is with people's stories. That's kind of the spine or the backbone. I I explore with people of their stories. And so individually, that may mean we're talking about a specific story, or it may not mean. Like, I am trained to see the story regardless of what we're talking about. And so individual work for me looks like we're on a screen. It's a dance. You're leading the dance. I'm following. I'm helping you navigate. And I'm asking lots of questions and creating a lot of space. I invite the body to be a part of that in a lot of ways. I do a lot of somatic work in my sessions. And a lot of people are, I mean, I will always see your story and name that. I always say everything is connected to different stories. And as we explore those, we get to kind of touch into places maybe that still have open wounds and heal differently, let me guess. And so people enjoy, I have a few ministry spouses who would rather be an individual because they're really uncomfortable at all being in any kind of group and being transparent. And I get that. It took me a long time. I personally have been in a group for over 4 years, same group. And they have become my anchors in this world. And so groups, I run groups, they go in 10-week sessions, and then they open up if there's spots for people to join. And the way those look are very specific to story. And so I do some teaching, and it's alternated with teaching how to write a story. I say write in quotes because it's not anything to do with a gift of writing. And people bring a story, a childhood story that they have recalled, and they read it. And then I teach the group how to engage in that story and how we bring a lot of curiosity into the story to, if you think of that balloon I was talking about, it's the other perspectives. Our narrative is true. It's not that our narrative is not true, but our narratives were developed. Most of them were developed very early. And there is a fuller truth to our narratives. We just can't see them. And so that's kind of what happens in the groups. And there are, I like to say they're very safe. I bring a lot of safety to them, and we talk a lot about that. I have a co-ed group, and I have an all-female group currently, and I have space to do another group if there was interest too, and see how that, like, I've thought about different time. I think I offered at one point one for ministry spouses in particular. Wasn't a ton of response, but maybe someday. And then so yeah, that's the difference. And it takes a lot of courage. I think it takes immense courage to step into therapy. I think it takes so much courage to step into group therapy. And to me, group therapy is a little bit like therapy on steroids. That's how I see it.
Well, it's a great way, especially for those of us in ministry families, if we are struggling with isolation, we're not having a regular experience of intimate relationship or intimate community. It's a great way to kind of get those training wheels going, right? And learning healthy ways to relate to each other again, which we all need. We were all, like we said, we were created for this. We were designed to need one another in order to thrive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So Kim, let our listeners and those who are going to view this later know how they can get in touch with you. And give us a little bit of information about that.
Yeah. You can find me on my website, which is Kimberly E. Hoke. And that is, I guess, do I spell it? Because it's probably not. K-I-M-B-E-R-L-Y, the letter E, and my last name is H-O-C-K. And that's KimberlyEhoke.com is my website. I'm also on Instagram. wish I could tell you that handle. I can't. I know there's two underscores in it. Maybe it's Kimberly underscore E underscore Hoke. I don't know. I have a lot on Instagram. That's a great place to kind of see what I'm offering, what I'm doing, that kind of thing.
Okay.
I've got it. It's Kimberly underscore E underscore Hoke on Instagram. And we'll put it in the chat as well.
Okay.
Yeah. We do have one question that came in, if you're okay with that.
I think so.
Someone was asking if you see teenage clients. If not, would you have some recommendations, maybe some other avenues that people could explore, especially for pastors' kids? So people want therapy according to their values, obviously, but that's important for them. But do you have any suggestions along those lines?
Yeah, I currently do not see any teens. Not that I wouldn't. I've mostly seen young adults on. And I'd have to kind of provide a resource. I don't have that resource in mind right now.
Sure.
But I think there are places that would be good and specific for teens. Yeah, I don't have that.
So could someone contact you through your website and maybe
Absolutely.
Get some referral ideas?
Yeah. Great. There's a button on my website that's contact me, and it sends an email right to me. So
great. Thanks.
Excellent. Well, and Kim, before we wrap up too, I was just thinking, you know, you talked about the tremendous courage that it takes to pursue therapy, whether individual therapy or in a group context. And I noticed, I wrote down something you said earlier in our conversation, which is that our past trauma is a part of why we're called to what we're called to. And so I just wanted to see if you could tease out a little bit. I know we're trying to wrap up here, but sometimes we hesitate to go to therapy, or we even shy away from genuine relationships because we're afraid, right? We're afraid of what's going to be unearthed. We're afraid of what we're going to have to confront that we've been working so hard to not be aware of. But I love that comment from you, part that our trauma is a part of why we're called to what we're called to, because that's so hopeful. It's mm-hmm. like, if you engage in this work, if you pursue therapy, whether as an individual or in a group setting, you might discover some of why the Lord has placed you where he's placed you, mm-hmm. or the certain type of gifting that you have. Can you talk about that just a little bit? There can be some good riches. Yeah.
I think about how I said earlier, like I realized I've actually been in training to be a therapist my whole life. One of the themes in my story is I had to contort, I had to watch everything and everybody and contort myself to figure out and read everyone around me to know how to show up. And boy, what a great therapeutic skill that is to be able to observe and watch. And now, unfortunately, the reason I had to do that was out of survival. And yet I think God intended it for good. And I wouldn't actually have known that had I not gone to therapy and started to explore and see like where my giftings were. I often say to people, and this is probably a Dan Allender quote, I have no idea because I just read so many, but I think it's probably from him. But I always say it is from our deepest woundings is where our greatest passions come. It's from our deepest woundings, from where our greatest passions come. Yeah. And we don't like to, and that's not to spiritualize or spiritually bypass or say, your trauma is good. And so therefore, you know, like that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying we actually have to get deep into our deepest woundings to discover and to figure out, oh, okay, this is how I am gifted.
Mm-hmm. one of the core values that we have as a ministry that we've discovered in the work that we do that corresponds to that is the redemptive quality of pain. That pain is not necessarily, the trauma is not good, but God is able to redeem that and make it, it is a part of our stories.
Yeah, there's no way for the resurrection to happen without death.
Yeah, right.
It doesn't exist.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Somebody else asked what your feelings might be about therapy for neurodivergence, you know, people who experience that.
I think it's great.
Okay.
I think it's great. I think neurodivergent folks absolutely need help navigating the world. We all do. And our world is not set up for the neurodivergent. And there's a lot. It feels and seems as if there's a lot of challenges. And so I think it's a great, and I think there are specific therapists who will work with specifically neurodivergent. If you just get on Psychology Today, you type in that in your search bar, you'll probably find some, but I don't know that, I mean, you get to figure that out. You may want to explore a little bit. I don't know that that's even necessary, but some people may want a more specific training for that.
Thank you, Kim. That's very helpful. Yes, many, many of us have loved ones who are neurodivergent in one way or another. And so it's just helpful to hear that encouragement to pursue therapy, pursue that kind of support as well.
Yeah.
Well, I am just, again, so grateful for this time together today, Kim. Roy, thank you also for being my faithful co-host here. I think we could talk for 3 hours on these themes, and it would all be helpful to our viewers, but they probably don't want to watch that long. But I'm grateful, especially, Kim, that our folks can get a hold of you to follow up if they're interested in pursuing either individual therapy or being a part of a story group. So again, we've included in the chat for this session link to Kim's website, KimberlyEHoke.com, or you can follow her on Instagram, which I do, at Kimberly_E_Hoke. And she puts out some great material there. Just good nourishment for your soul. So Kim, any last words before we wrap up today? Anything you'd like to leave us with as pastors and pastor spouses?
Yeah, I didn't really think about that, but what comes to mind is just kindness. I feel like often my experience of being a ministry spouse was I often felt so stuck and there was just nowhere. And I want to offer that there is, and you don't have to carry this by yourself. And there's a lot of people that relate and can connect. And it may just take a couple reaches.
Beautiful. Absolutely. That's a great word. Yes, we would all be happy to be one of those people. If any of you watching are recognizing a need in yourself or in your family, any one of the three of us would be happy to help you find the next steps for you as you pursue health and wholeness as a follower of Christ and as a beloved child. We want to remind you that we have many previous episodes in this webinar series. So I've included in the chat a link to our YouTube playlist where you can watch all the previous episodes in this partnership between the EPC and PIR Ministries. I also wanted to make sure you know that we have another episode coming up on August 13th. We're going to be joined that day, Roy and I, by Gail Goolsby, who is a counselor and life coach, also a pastor's wife. We're going to be talking with Gail about the topic of navigating transition. So be sure to stay tuned, and thank you all for watching today. We pray that the Lord will just continue to work in you what is good and pleasing to His will, bringing you more and more into that love relationship with the Trinity that we've been invited into in Christ. So Roy, would you mind wrapping us up in prayer today?
I'd be glad to.
Thank you.
Lord God, again, thank you for your grace and mercy that meets us each day, for the time we've had together with Kim today. Pray that all who listen to this will be encouraged and will get a better understanding of what it means to be a healthy pastoral family. Thank you for Kim and her work. May you continue to bless her in that. And we ask that you would glorify your name through this day in our lives. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Blessings to you all.